Okay, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So alhamdulillah, today also I have a really honored guest. His name is Brother Akbar Khoja, and he runs a website that educates our Ismaili brothers and sisters in humanity and people of humanity about what is Ismailism, who are the Ismailis, what is their aqidah. And the reason we are doing this is because this is not a program that we want to belittle any faith, any group, any ideology. This channel is to educate people about what Islam is and what Islam is not. So all of us at the end of the day, we can come together as one human family and we worship the Creator and by His mercy, inshallah, go to paradise. So this is an educational session and I hope and pray that all of you can benefit from it, inshallah. So with that, I will have Brother Akbar Khoja to introduce himself and briefly mention his website and dwell into the topic, inshallah.
Jazakallah khair, Brother Sabeel. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh to you and to all the viewers who are listening to us right now and would be listening to us, inshallah, for years and years to come. This is Akbar Khoja. I'm a revert to Islam and I left Ismailism over a decade back. And I've dedicated my life to spreading awareness about Ismailism in both ways, you know, telling Muslims what is Ismailism and telling Ismailis about Islam, you know, and that's a bigger part because I believe Ismailis usually do not, unfortunately, get exposed to the real Islam. They are made to believe that what they are doing is Islam. And I've been running a few projects. One of them is www.insidesmalism.net, which actually would tell people what's happening in Ismailism. And rethinkingismailism.com is another project which was targeted towards Ismailis. But now, you know, these projects are pretty much converging, coming together, and Rethinking Ismailism is, you know, the main da'wah focused website, which I have. I have a YouTube channel by the same name. I have a Facebook page, which goes by the same name, Rethinking Ismailism. That's the focus. And what I meant to say, what I just alluded upon, was that Ismailis never get to see what a real Islam is. And that's the exact reason what I wanted to do today was present to Ismailis what are the five pillars within Islam. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said that the foundation of Islam is upon the five, the testimony of the faith, prayer, fasting, Hajj and Zakat. So Brother Sabeel, what I want to do today is touch upon each of them briefly, hopefully not spending, you know, more than 5 to 10 minutes on each of them. And then we can conclude. We'll also, what we'll try to do is touch upon a da'wah point, a lesson learned, as I would say,
lesson for each of them.
Yeah. And, you know, see, what's the take home message for our Ismaili brothers and sisters and those Muslim brothers and sisters who are talking to anybody who's Ismaili? So with your permission, Brother Sabeel.
Yes, as you start, I can also mention to the viewers, mashallah, Brother Akbar Khoja, he's a revert to Islam. He was born and raised in a family whose aqidah was Ismaili. And mashallah, he consciously, after research, he converted to Islam. And you can watch his conversion story on the same channel, the Sabeel Ahmed channel. And also we did one more episode that gives the overview of who Ismailis are, their aqidah, their background, their history. So the viewers can also watch that episode on the same channel, inshallah. Go ahead, Brother Akbar.
JazakAllah khair, Brother Sabeel, for that. So the first component I want to touch upon is the testimony of the faith, which is the kalma. So this is what we last time touched upon. So I just wanted to recollect because the pillars of faith are really given a esoteric or batini meaning within Ismailism. True salah, true fast, true hajj, true zakah, true salat. Everything is redefined within Ismailism. So these are the other components here. But essentially, what the message is that, unfortunately, within the 12th century, when the Nizari Ismaili abrogation of Sharia happened through their 23rd Imam, these pillars were more or less demolished. They were redefined. They were reconstructed, given a totally new meaning. Their physical essence was replaced with more of a spiritual essence, but the core message is, how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam practice them? How did Ali karamallahu wajhu practice these pillars? They all practice these pillars in their physical sense, right? And if you're saying that due to some reason, you know, due to some strange interpretation, what they were doing was somehow not valid at that time, then you're actually rejecting what they were doing, you know, saying that, you know, that was the age, that was a different age, and they were doing it for different reasons, and this is how we want to do it. This is not coming from Quran and Sunnah. This doesn't have any basis in Quran and Sunnah. So that's the overall message of the five pillars. Let's go to the testimony.
Right, Akbar, in the last episode, you mentioned that how the 23rd Imam of theirs, they abolished the Sharia that was brought by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as given in the Quran and through the Sunnah of his. Abolishing it, that means they abolished the five pillars and they gave a different meaning to each one of them.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's exactly what I showed in the previous slide, that, you know, Salat, Fast, Zakat, Hajj, Jihad, everything was given a different meaning. And we also touched upon how jihad has always been redefined by certain quote-unquote reformers due to, you know, reasons which are somehow not influenced by a lot of factors other than religious reasons. But I also wanted to share something else which we didn't touch upon last time as a prelude to the five pillars. The Ismaili account of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam's mission is very, very different as compared to what the normal mainstream Islam views. And this slide, which is there on the screen right now, this is being presented by one of their Ismaili missionaries. And look at what he says. He says that the spiritual training and initiation for each prophet was provided by the Imam of their time through his da'i. That's what he says. So what he's saying is that, na'uzubillah, the prophet, any prophet, he says, is actually trained by the Imam of their time. And each, so remember last time we showed that each prophet has a da'i and an Imam, and you know, there's an Imam in each period and so forth. So what they say is that, and this is from one of their books, the reference of which is given below. Let's read what is said here. It says, for Qadi Nu'man, as for later Fatima Ismaili's authors, the calling or the da'wah in each of the prophetic cycles comes to signify the corporeal, physical component of the ranks of religion. The calling of each epoch, like the ranks of religion, thereby provides the necessary training or tarbiyah, not least for individual practitioners, but for the prophets as well. The true prophetic essence of Ibrahim and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam run along parallel lines. Each ascent narrative commences with initiation into the ranks of religion and culminates in the recognition of God's unity. So in the Ismaili hierarchy, if you look at number 7, the respondent, it says Ibrahim alayhi salam was spiritually educated by the da'is, hujjas and babs and the Imam himself. And to them, the breaker, to number 6, is the sun. So remember that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he looked at the suns and the moons and the stars, right? And that's what it says in the Quran, right? And he said that, you know, they cannot be gods. So the Ismaili ta'wil says that, you know, when he looked at the sun and the moon and the stars, Ibrahim alayhi salam, look at number 4, Ibrahim alayhi salam didn't really worship a star. You know, that's so Ismaili Ta'wil says that, you know, saying that Ibrahim alayhi salam worshipped a star is actually a very degrading thing to associate a prophet with. So the Ismaili Ta'wil says that, you know, we the Ismailis give a higher rank to the prophets, and rather than, you know, the way the mainstream Islam does. And, you know, the sun was actually the breaker, and the moon was also a teacher or muallim, and the star was a da'i. And this is how Ibrahim alayhi salam, you know, ascended in the ranks, and then he became a prophet. So look at
the first
look
point
at the first
you have up here, Brother Akbar.
Yeah.
It says Imam. According to them, the Quranic story, according to their version of it, that Ibrahim alayhi salam actually worshipped, you know, na'udzubillah, the moon or the creation before he started worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that the what we get from that point?
Yeah, and that's what you call a straw man. So that's a straw man that they built. Mm-hmm. And then they demolished the straw man by saying that, you know, we don't say that.
I see.
So that's you know, that's the extent to which Ta'wil can go. You know, it can, and you see this everywhere. Ta'wil, what it does, it builds on various numerous straw men, and then destroys them with, you know, some logic and some rationality, and which doesn't come from Quran and Sunnah. It's just accounts of people like Adi Nu'man and Abu Yaqub Sijistani and so forth. Most Ismailis, they don't even know this. You know, this is only visible, and you know, this is only in the books of Ismaili scholars and missionaries who go and want to study these classical texts, right? And that's how, that's where this is. Normal Ismailis, they don't go into this. They are just, you know, to me, they are innocent people who unfortunately don't have the time to, who, I mean, they haven't got to the stage of, you know, exploring what really Ismailism is, because if they explore it, this is what they'll get.
When you mentioned Ta'wil, right, you are saying that this is the exegesis or the interpretation of the various passages, ayahs of the Quran.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And we also touched upon last time, if you remember, I also mentioned that Laylatul Qadr, right? Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr. Ismailis have a different interpretation of that as well, because they say that, you know, nowhere is the Quran mentioned in this ayah. So who here, the Arabic who, doesn't refer to the Quran, it refers to the Imam and so forth. So those are different interpretations, and you'll find different videos on that on my channel. So that's a detailed topic. I know we want to keep this under an hour, so let me move to the testimony of faith within Ismailism. Now, you know, one of the, you know, cores of Ismaili belief and practice is actually their prayer. Their prayer is called the holy dua. Ismailis would normally argue that if somebody would ask them that, why don't you pray, they would say, or why don't you offer namaz, right, as you would say in the subcontinent, they would say, hey, namaz doesn't appear in the Quran, only the word salah appears, and salah translates into dua. So what we do is actually the proper salah, which is commanded in the Quran, it's actually the dua. So the dua, which is the Ismaili prayer, it's we have a section for prayer dedicated. That's going to be a bigger section. I just want to touch upon the testimony of faith, which is very interesting. So this is an excerpt. This is a part two, or in Muslim terms, whether Shia or Sunni terms, this is a second rak'ah of their prayer, and this is a transliteration. I picked up the English translation and the English transliteration. So this is how the Ismaili testimony of faith, or the kalma, it appears in their holy dua. It says, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah Aliyun Amirul Mu'minin Aliyullah. So the way they translate it, it goes, there's no deity except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Ali, the master of believers, which is Ali and Amir al-Mu'mineen, is from Allah. Strange meaning, because whosoever knows a little bit of Arabic knows that Aliullah doesn't translate into is from Allah. If you would say Aliul Amir al-Mu'mineen min Allah, you know, it's okay, that's from Allah. But it just says Aliun Amir al-Mu'mineen Aliullah. So let's go to, you know, people can say, okay, this might be, you know, misrepresentation, mistranslation, you know, it's just transliterated. The Arabic text might be different. So here we go. This is the Arabic text. It appears in an Urdu book, which is until a few years back, till the curriculum got revised. This was taught in just grade 2 of the Ismaili jamatkhana night schools, as they call it, or religious education centers. And this is what the children are taught. It says, this is the testimony of faith. And the Arabic text is very clear. It says, Aliyun Amirul Mu'mineen Aliullah. And the translation again is, Ali is from Allah. So I reached out to, I know Arabic myself, but I've also reached out to my Arabic teachers, and they've attested that that Ali is from Allah. The Arabic for is not the correct Arabic when if you want to translate it to Ali is from Allah. Ali radiallahu anh was Amirul Mu'mineen. We all agree, and nobody denies that. But Aliullah is just a misrepresentation, I would say. You know, a simple mudaf alayhi rule says Aliullah would mean Ali of Allah. You know, just like Rasulullah means Rasul of Allah. So there's a mudaf alayhi relationship. The similar relationship would exist between Aliullah, and it just translates into Ali of Allah, which doesn't really mean anything. So that's something to look at in the testimony of faith.
So the viewers may be thinking, have you had any conversation with any Ismaili brothers or sisters and ask them the question, what does it mean that Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu is from Allah? I mean, what does it mean? How what is their perception of that phrase?
Yeah, so interesting conversations a few which I've had on this topic. First of all, on the mistranslation, on the I would say misconstruction of the Arabic, none of the Ismailis I've spoken with, they would accept. They would say, no, this is what it means. Aliullah means Ali is from Allah. So even if I would say, okay, what do you mean Ali is from Allah? So they would usually, when it comes to this point, Ismailis would usually lean towards taking the Shi'i point of view and saying that, you know, Ali radiallahu anh was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Amirul Mu'mineen. That's, you know, they would again, like I said, they would lean, they would take, take some help from the Shi'i point of view in holding this together, right? Mm-hmm. Because and they would do this in a lot of places, because there are a lot of arguments in which they would, you know, take refuge into pulling out Shi'i arguments and bringing them into Ismailism. Even though Shia, they don't see Ismailis as part of the Shi'i school of thought. Now the question is, what's the takeaway in this, right? So what's the dawah point is this? And I think you've dovetailed into that perfectly, because that's the question, right? If you are a da'i speaking to a Ismaili brother or sister, or if you're a Ismaili listening to this program right now, there are two questions to ask. First of all, is this a correct Arabic translation or composition or construction? If you want to say Ali is from Allah, the answer is no, it's not. Go ask any Arabic teacher. The second question is what you said, Brother Sabeel, and may Allah bless you, right? You said, what does it really mean is from Allah? Don't we say inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un? Aren't we all from Allah and unto him we all shall return? Isn't that true? So how are we, you know, how is this so different than what we are? We are all from Allah, right?
So unique to Ali Raziallahu Ta'ala, why him? I mean, all of us are in that category, right? But even a bigger question is that Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in an authentic narration, he said, pray like the way that you see me pray. But when you are showing the evidence from their own books that their prayer is different, what do they say regarding that then? Do they accept the ahadiths that we have or they don't?
That's interesting. If you want, we can, you know, straight away go into the Ismaili prayer. But that's a good point to start from. They would usually, unfortunately, they would just say that, you know, the Quran, it doesn't describe how to pray.
I see.
And therefore, you know, our Imam has now come up with a new method to pray, and which is according to the current times that we live in. That's their view. Do you want us to, you know, move on to the Ismaili prayer? There's just one more slide on the testimony of faith, which
I just
want to
cover.
Yes,
let's go with the testimony of faith. Let's exhaust that one, then we can move to the other pillars of Islam, inshallah.
Yeah, so just wanted to end the testimony of faith with a quote from the 32nd Ismaili Imam. There's a book which is given the title of a peer, you know. It's called Pandiyate Jawamardi, or Advices of Manliness. It's ascribed to the second Imam Mustansir Billah. There were two Mustansir Billah imams called Mustansir Billah. This book is usually ascribed to him. Nobody knows if he really wrote it or not. But this is what it says. You know, it's right there. It's one of the very, very respected Ismaili texts. So it's not like, you know, somebody else wrote it. It's one of the Ismaili core texts. It says, it is obligatory and necessary for the true believer to recognize his creator, who is manifest in this world in the form of a human being, and to see him here in order to see him also in the hereafter. So what you see right now is a picture of the current Aga Khan, and they believe, and this is what their text says, that it's the believer, for him it's necessary to recognize his creator, who is manifest in the world in the form of a human being. So again, something to think about for the Ismailis.
You know, that phrase that you said, manifest, I'm reminded of the Bible, in which the Christians, they say that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, is a manifestation, incarnation, or any which way that they look at it, that God became human. It gives interpretation to that manifestation verbiage that they have.
And the Arabic word that the Ismailis use, or the Ismaili missionaries use, is mazhar, right? Mazhar is obviously the place of something happening. So the place where zuhur happens is called the mazhar. So na'uz billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes himself zahir, or appear in the place which is the imam. So that's the faith. Another farman, or another saying, by Aga Khan the Third, who was the previous Aga Khan, he said, for the betterment of faith, I wish to tell you one thing that includes everything. The most essential thing is that your faith on the successor of the Prophet and Hazrat Ali, which is himself, should be stronger than your love for your mother, father, wealth, and your life. If you will have love for the progeny of the Prophet and Hazrat Ali, then you will have nothing to fear in this world. This one farman contains all the qualities of ibadat, bandagi, and the deen, which is religion. So the Prophet, if you remember, Brother Sabeel, what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that none of you is complete in his faith until he loves me more than his, you know, and then he enumerated all the relatives, right? And that saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is na'udhu billah, he's superseding that with, you know, saying that your love should be on the successor of the Prophet and Hazrat Ali. You must have noted that, brother Sabeel, immediately.
Yes,
right?
So one point I was going to also make in here is, you know, this is the harm of following anyone blindly. If we leave the Quran in the Sunnah and start following anyone blindly, then we can do anything or any form of prayer that may be so alien to what the Prophet did or what he brought, what he preached. So this is a good lesson for every human being, not just Muslim, not just Ismailis, every Muslim, that we should know who Allah is, we should know who the Prophet and the books. You know, when we deviate away from it, that's when all of these different faiths, they were created by humans. I think this is the most important lesson that I can think when you're going over the slides. I'm thinking, you know, may Allah protect us and may Allah bring people back again to the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet. Peace be upon him.
Just one more slide, since we're on the testimony of faith and touching about Tawheed. One of the slides which was recently presented by a Ismaili quote-unquote scholar says it is not shirk that, you know, a question was asked that, you know, when the Quran says إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, then Ismailis would ask, don't we like worship the Imam, and isn't this, you know, totally contrary to إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ? And that's what it says in the top, right? Mm-hmm. That, you know, when the Quran says, thee alone we worship, and thee alone we ask for help. Isn't this contrary to that, what we do? And he says, it's not shirk, because God's self-manifestation, the universal intellect, right, shines through the Imam's pure humanity and is witnessed by his creatures. Many Sunni Sufis believe the Prophet Muhammad and highest Sufi saint is the mazhar of God's name. I don't know who he's referring to, but that's his justification. He accepts the proximity to shirk, or actually it is shirk, but he acknowledges that and says, you know, it is not because of these reasons. And then he says, God's help reaches humans through various intermediaries. These all are mazahir of God, and the Imam is the highest mazhar of God on earth. Many Sunnis, again, he takes a branch from there to just hold on to. And he says, many Sunnis recognize the mediation of Prophet Muhammad and various saints or awliya. So there, you know, their excuse is to look at those people within the mainstream Islam or Sunni Islam or whether it's Shia Islam, right? But whoever is performing any ghulu or anything which is close to shirk, they would take that as an example and say that since they are doing it, we also do it, right? Mm. And that's their excuse. And there are some other, there's some other text here from Raza Shah Kazmi, which people can read to, and we'll skip that in the interest of...
Again, with this slide, again, what I can take away from it is that they're mixing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes with the humans, with the prophets, with the non-prophets. So that's one area that they're doing the mixing, even though there should be separate. Creator's attributes are separate from the creation. Secondly, what they're doing is they're mixing the attributes, the position, the honor of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and other prophets with the non-prophets, which are the imams of the Ismailis. So they're again mixing that together. And I think that's, they went off track from the true Islam.